Do not be afraid of being saints. This is the freedom for which Christ set us free. John Paul II. I'll try to love my neighbor as myself. And I'll try to make everyone around me happy. Not only should we be grateful for the gifts received, we should also enrich them. Enrique Shaw's life, a sailor, the founder of the Christian Association of Business Executives, the representative director of the Rigola, a family man, a secular apostle, this is the testimony of a person who wanted to help others to get closer to God and who achieved it. Enrique Shaw, a life, a testimony. Enrique was born in Paris on February 26, 1921, in Alejandro Shaw's and Sarah Tornquist's home. His father was the founder and president of Shaw Bank, and in those days, he was a representative of the Tornquist house in France. Shortly after, the family returns to Buenos Aires, and everyone enjoys a home full of love. Enrique plays with Alejandro, his elder brother, receives his father's protection and his mother's loving hugs. There is nothing missing in their home. The Shaws live in their small paradise. But a painful and unexpected event changes their lives forever. On August 27th, 1925, Sarah passes away. But before dying, she makes her husband promise their sons will be educated in the Christian faith. That is the way she chooses to remain in their hearts. Even though Mr. Alejandro was not a believer, he keeps his promise. His sons take the first Holy Communion with Father Goicochea in the Basilica of the Holy Sacrament. Alejandro and their aunts try to relieve the children's pain because of their mother's absence. The vacations are a moment for the family to get together. Enrique has fun, travels, shares moments with friends, and gives free rein to his joy. He is happy playing with his father, and he can't be asked to stop moving or smiling. Life is a big smile and is full of action, but it is a game for the time being. The restless boy still doesn't know his adult life will be marked by the same process. Happiness and action. But his childhood games don't prevent him from forgetting his duties. He helps in mass as an altar boy, and he is a brilliant student in Roca and La Salle, the schools he attends.
He distinguished himself since he was a boy by being a good son and an excellent student. He was in the honors board of the La Salle School, where I also attended. It was very hard to be in the honors board of the La Salle School.
Maybe because of his religious education in the La Salle School, his mom's invisible protection, or just because his special nature demands it, Enrique grows in wisdom, love for God, and in Marian devotion. He has got everything a child his age can wish for. But there's something that hurts him. He lacks the family he had during his first years. His father often leaves on business trips, and although his aunts take good care of him, the emptiness left by his mother still runs deep. So he asks God in his prayers not to allow him to be beaten by sadness and not let his character soften because of enjoying his privileges. And even though he was young, he takes his first decision as a responsible man. He'll embark again, but not to have fun this time. Now, He is ready to serve his country, tempering his character and becoming strong against all odds. Before turning 15, he joins the Navy in the 1966 promotion. Alejandro Shaw doesn't understand why his son has chosen that career. And during one of his leaves of absence, Enrique goes to explain. He travels to New York on his own, without knowing in which hotel his father is staying. But that's no obstacle for him. They finally meet, and Mr. Alejandro realizes his son is so determined, he can only encourage him and give him advice. Follow your path then, making the most of your work, with or without applaud. You should be interested in achieving what you have set out to do, not in receiving praises. The first days in the Navy are hard. Enrique is the youngest of them all, and his mates take advantage of this to play jokes on him, especially when seeing him praying before going to bed. But he doesn't complain or hide his faith.
He was a man who wanted to set examples by doing very personal things regarding morality. That cost him a lot. And I know this because his mates and some friends of mine, who are sailors, told me about it.
He tries very hard, and little by little, he gains everyone's respect, bettering himself every day. He improves his sporting abilities, he devotes himself to study, and in the loneliness of his cabin, he finds a friend, a confidant from which he will never separate. His journal.
He always wrote. He kept big journals when he was a boy. And then he kept small notebooks. There, he used to write his ideas straight away.
This writing turns into a dialogue with himself and with God. And everyday life, the work on the ship, that vast universe of sea and sky, seem to have other meaning once it's reflected in his journal. The Navy isn't just obedience and command. It is also the sunrises, the clouds, the stars, and the nights of full moon, the long waves breaking against the vessel, and the big ones arriving and bursting in beauty. Enrique is certain that the Navy is his place, and faces this future full of optimism. He embarks on the ship La Argentina, on his first voyage as a Navy cadet, and most of his destinations are located in the south of the country. As an officer, he doesn't allow the injustice he tolerated in the past. When I talk about military laws, I always want to instill interest. At least, I don't just read the rules to them. During his permissions, he shares moments with friends, but deep inside, he was rather different from all of them. I'm full of a healthy joy and satisfaction about my job, my people, because of what I learn, because I have fun. I'll try to love my neighbor as myself in order to fulfill the second commandment of God's law. And looking for the way to make the people around me happy, I'll spread my religion. His calling for giving Christ's message to the sailors leads him to start teaching catechism when sailing or while anchored at some harbor. Thus, he manages to make many people take part in Mass and take communion. He feels very happy when receiving a letter from a conscript's mother, who thanks him because his teachings have changed her son's life. Gradually, Enrique's life also changes. His smile starts to shine with a different light. he feels closer and closer to God and becomes a new man. Strangely, this conversion, as he calls it, arrives during a vacation in Mar del Plata, where he finds a book about the social doctrine of the church. The day of my 20th birthday, I asked God to grow the fruit he wanted in me, to make me aware of my sins, and to decisively and completely convert me. What makes a man more human is how much he receives from the divine. And happily, now I'm starting to feel a supernatural reception. But what he learns, those glad tidings he receives from God, are of no worth if he cannot share them. He aims to talk with the common man as an equal, because he knows it is not necessary to become a priest to talk about God. He knows lay people are also part of the church. He is sure everyone, from their position, can find a moment to live the Gospels. I should irradiate love and joy to make our religion appealing. Charity involves being kind and cheerful. His job in the Navy and his preaching make him a happy man. However, Enrique dreams about something else: the love of a woman, the love of a family. It is at this moment when an old acquaintance from his childhood reappears in his life, Cecilia.
I'd already met him, but in a wedding, when I was young, in a conference held by my uncle Alejandro Bunge. I knew who he was, and I knew how he was, but that didn't mean we knew each other. Then we got to know each other in parties. We became friends. I went to see him off with the whole group. I thought he looked at me differently.
Cecilita, as he used to call her, soon becomes someone special.
Then we stopped seeing each other. We went different ways. We started seeing each other again a year later, when we started dating.
Cecilia is architect Jorge Bunge's daughter, and like Enrique, has also suffered her mother's loss as a child. They love each other, but spending their lives together won't be easy. Jorge Bunge thinks his only daughter is too young to get married. The voyages also drift the lovers apart, and letters are almost the only way to express their feelings. At last, after 2 years of courtship, everything's ready for the wedding. This is my last letter, as I'll return to Buenos Aires full of love and excitement to join you forever. However, at the last minute, the bride receives some unpleasant news.
3 days before, Enrique called me and told me he didn't know if he was able to make it, because he had argued with an admiral. He was right, but the admiral had given him 3 days of prison. He told me, "Don't tell anybody, but I don't know if I can make it. Have the party, because your father and mine have always longed to give the party. But we always wanted to get married in private and in the Holy Sacrament Church. So let them give the party, welcome the guests, And then we can get married the following week. I couldn't believe it. I told him, Enrique, that's not the same. But he was 22, and at that age, one is often optimistic.
Hopes fade away. But suddenly, Enrique's courage and moral integrity because of saying what he thinks, even when his own happiness is at stake, are rewarded. The authorities lift his punishment, and Enrique makes it to his wedding. We'll look at the world around us and at our children with pure and kind eyes. The earth will be beautiful for us. The Lord asks of us only one great victory, the one of our tender and constant love. Many friends share the couple's happiness in the farmhouse La Cecilia in Muñiz. Alejandro Shaw and Jorge Bunge are two proud and moved fathers. Enrique's happy. From now on, he'll have the family he so wanted, and he fully enjoys it as a man-boy who recovers the joy of childhood.
I was 12 or 13 years old. We were invited to the wedding, and one of the things I remember is that he was dressed in his uniform. The party was in Muñiz, in a farmhouse. After lunch, he went out with me to walk around. It was a rainy day, and it was all muddy. He ended up rolling in the mud with us, because we started playing. He was an incredible guy.
The young couple's life becomes a life of happiness and fulfillment, and they dream about having a big family.
Enrique told me, look, I've been talking to my mates. Everyone wants to know the number of children we'll have. When they asked me, I told them 13, because if I said 12, they would have thought I was superstitious. But they are 13, taking into account the four I lost.
But his army duties drift him apart again. The separation is sad. Their first baby is about to be born, and Enrique would like to be there. As he sails the southern seas, he thinks about his baby's birth and feels something new is being born in his soul. His idea of leaving the Navy to go on with his preaching near his family and on solid ground grows stronger. However, the war postpones his wishes. The Navy and his country ask him for a sacrifice, and Enrique obeys, but he becomes surer and surer about his thoughts. Catholics are the light of the world. They are the ferment that raises the skeptical masses. It doesn't mean we have to take that ferment. We are that ferment. Almost at the end of the world, the Navy sends him to the United States to study meteorology. This time, he is able to travel with his family. Without knowing, he was embarking on a journey that got him closer to those changes he so much longed for. And New York would be again the place that marked his course.
He was at the gunwale of the vessel when he saw the Statue of Liberty. And he told me he had a divine inspiration. I must leave the Navy. I should do something else in my life, for the other's own good. I'll never forget those words. For the other's own good.
When he arrives, he learns the war is over. So he applies for his discharge from the Navy.
When the war was over, Enrique had already thought about leaving the Navy because he wanted to become a worker.
He is not afraid of the turn his life has taken. Like many people, he'll start all over from the beginning. He and his family's life, that wonderful school of charity, as he calls it, is in the hands of God. And he knows he won't abandon him. An uncle of Cecilia offers him an important position in the glass factory Rigolo. But Enrique is not sure about accepting that hierarchical position. He thinks if he worked as a worker, if he were one of them, he'd know their sufferings, their spiritual concerns, and he would be able to transmit the message of the Gospels in a better way.
I knew what he had told me, that a priest, whose name I can't recall now, invited him to dinner. He sketched a small drawing and told him, "Look, you can't be a worker. You don't have the face of a worker. You don't think like a worker. What you should do is sanctify or improve the business class."
In the end, he accepts the challenge circumstances present him. He becomes a high-level executive, but above all, he'll become a Christian businessman.
He found out he had a vocation for being a businessman. He had the idea of a company that really was at the service of the community, at the service of others, and above all, at the service of workers. He had a fundamental concern about the working people.
He stays in Corning, USA for a year, learning how a glass factory works.
And he started by training himself to be a good businessman, working at all the levels of the factory, not only at the administrative or executive level, but also descending to working places, talking to workers, dealing with the real situation of the people who work in companies.
Those are the times of learning, but also of deep happiness, because his first baby girl is born. Seeing his family growing, feeling happy, and after doing the training his job demands him, Enrique gets ready to walk along a new path. The workers of the glass factory see him arrive and realize he was someone special, a different kind of boss.
Between the managers and the workers, there was a wall that prevented them from starting any communication. Enrique didn't have that wall, so they felt comfortable when talking to him.
Enrique Shaw had a very good relationship with union members. He even used to invite them to his own home. There was this one union member that didn't want to go because he couldn't understand how they could possibly go to the boss's house. The following day he said, "You know, it's incredible. The union members actually went to Mr. Shaw's house, and he called his kids and explained to them, 'These men should be in the factory, because sometimes we commit injustice and don't understand certain things. So they call our attention, helping all to reach an agreement.'"
Each businessman and each worker, by working together, build social peace. Conflicts of interests are normal, not conflicts of class. Enrique expressed his ideas about the boss-worker relationship, which were engraved in Carlos García Díaz's memory.
"What the worker needs isn't a paternal protection, but to be treated according to his or her personality, to be respected for his dignity as a worker, for his or her conscience of being a free person."
What I found stunning was something he said one day, that if a brother didn't go towards him, he would have to go to him. Maybe an employee or worker didn't dare go near the boss and tell him a problem. So if he found out anything, he would go, wherever, to the workshop, to the furnace, to know what the problem was. The problems were always solved.
For Enrique, a businessman is an engine that should be started by the heat created by God. And that heat always means love. Enrique loved the workers, and he took into account their needs and applied means to satisfy them, helping them to discover what was good in them, encouraging them to think and to take their own initiatives.
That love for your neighbor, love above all, love your neighbor as yourself is the main commandment. Enrique truly exercised it.
But his mission has just started. There is still a lot to do for the workers' sake, not only in the glass factory. Faithful to his restless nature, Enrique travels to the Vatican and to other European cities. He wants to listen to the word of the church regarding the world of work, because what he wishes is to turn his factory into a place worthy of everyone. To fulfill that purpose, he is ready to act more than ever. Back together with some businessmen he met at the end of the war, when they had gotten together to send provisions to the devastated countries. Enrique knows they can change the workers' and the factory's realities. So they talk, they argue, and agree to do something. They can be efficient businessmen, but above all, they have to commit themselves to give testimony of the Gospels in their work environment. So they decide to found ACDE in 1952. ACDE is the Spanish acronym for Christian Association of Business Executives, created with the solidarity and the service of a new business class.
I got to know him through his apostolic action, which can be divided into three: his actions in the Catholic Union, in ACDE, and in the Christian Family Movement, under the supervision of Father Moledo. Father Moledo was an ideal for all of us. The fact that Father Moledo was an influence was an incentive.
With Father Moledo's advice, ACDE starts working. Enrique is appointed president. Grateful because of this acknowledgement, he raises his voice to transmit his message. The business action cannot be separated from the life of a community. As a consequence, business actions have an effect on the nation's entire life.
And these laymen, who were the first group of the Catholic Union, encouraged those who wanted to see a Catholic Argentina. So it left a really inspiring image. He was a nice person by nature, and he was enterprising regarding what he did in his factory, professionally speaking. So everything made us think, that's a kind of man we want to have a better nation.
ACDE opens a new path towards social coexistence. Sometime after its foundation, ACDE joins the International Christian Union of Business Executives, a prestigious institution that also takes care of workers' promotion.
I think ACDE has had a very significant role in the business community, through its permanent and persistent task to spread the Christian social doctrine over the economic and social fields. And regarding my experience, I saw in many occasions in the business field people who were interested and very committed to adopt those measures which were most consistent with this doctrine.
Enrique played a leading role in a clear example of the work done by ACDE businessmen.
He even took part in the elaboration of a very important law in those times, which was the Family Benefit Law. And that was the consequence of the work done by the young businessman Enrique Shaw with a group of young businessmen.
The mere contact with Enrique's personality was inspiring. He wasn't an arrogant boss. He didn't see the world from a place of honor. Instead, he had his feet on the ground to get to know those people, their families, their needs. And Enrique, by having this familiar contact with his workers, he elevated women because he knew what a woman means, because he had a wife who inspired him.
Enrique admires women and the image of the Celestial Mother, the Virgin Mary. He consults her about everything he does and receives protection and strength from her. They are hard times, and Enrique knows his partner, as he likes calling the Virgin, can help him create a new order in the business world. He suffers mistreatment in prison. However, he doesn't feel hate or bear malice. Instead, he offers forgiveness. We can never say a man is evil without being in danger of lying. We can only say he did a specific bad deed. But no conclusion can be drawn from yesterday to today, and much less from today to tomorrow. But the responsible businessman also allows himself time to feel warm at home. There, he is surrounded by the love of Cecilia and his children.
That deep love for his wife and kids stood out. Even the youngest, everyone had a place in the house. And he smiled with all of them.
He was very nice, very cheerful, like the kids. He was really, really happy. He liked being with kids.
He enjoys that noisy nest and revives his own childish mischief playing with each of his kids. God gave him the biggest happiness a man can feel, being the creator of a happy family. Each moment shared with his family is a celebration, and he can't miss that for nothing in the world.
He talked to them a lot about different things according to their ages. I saw him talking and talking and talking to them. One of my children had a series of problems and was operated when he was 8. I saw Enrique talking and talking to him. Years later, he told me Enrique had talked with him about the theology of pain. And he kept that in here because he was operated several times. Now he has to use a wheelchair. And he's always had that strength of spirit he wouldn't have had if his father hadn't talked to him.
During his holidays, he says, "Into the water we go." And there they all go to dive in. But he doesn't share this complicity only with his children. Every moment turns into a recess. It is about making a child happy.
He brought a beautiful motorcycle one day, and the kids in the neighborhood were amazed. They surrounded the motorcycle. Enrique had a meeting, and they were waiting for him, but he didn't turn up. Then someone said, "I'll go and see," because we saw him arrive a long time ago. Well, he was giving every kid a ride. There was a long line, and he gave each kid a ride.
He loves them, and they know that. And he makes everyone smile so that the celebration of being together will never end. But he doesn't doubt when having to impose limits. Like that one time in Pinamar, when one of his kids disappeared from the house for many hours and gave everyone a huge scare.
They left without asking for their parents' permission, and they were carried by the north wind, getting as far as Villagesel. So Enrique told him off. He said, "You abused your freedom because you didn't tell your mother. And the punishment? Well, since you abuse your freedom, tomorrow I will leave you here with some books so that you can read and enjoy." And he said, "You won't leave your room. You abused your freedom. So now you have to learn what it's like not to be free."
They should behave well in life, not to indulge me, but to understand they should lead a life of service. Enrique likes repeating a phrase because he embraces everyone with it. The family that prays together stays together.
And the rosary we played in family, it had, let's say, some mysteries, some sayings. For example, we prayed asking for more holy priests, for the government to be fair, and then there was one left for the kids who could ask for anything.
He also shares the world of the factory with his family. He wants his children to meet that other family, the one of the workers and the businessmen. That family he also wants to give the best to. That's why the days in the factory start very early.
We saw how everyone ran towards him to say hello when he arrived. "Mr. Shaw, Mr. Shaw!" And he came down and listened to them.
In those days, Riolo had around 3,600 workers. And when he went to the big factory in Birasategui, he entered and many people said hello to him as he walked around. And usually he called them by their name and asked them, for example, if their son John had got over. He knew everybody's problems.
Enrique is sure that he'll get to know his workers better if he loves them. That's why he goes near them, listens to them, and once again, the wall vanishes.
And he held out his hand to them with respect, with love. And they said to him, "Oh no, sir, my hands are dirty." "Oh no, my friend." And he hugs them and he held them by their arms.
At noon, he didn't leave to have lunch. He stayed walking around, and if his supervisor or boss was delayed, they asked, "Oh, are you still here? You haven't left yet?" "No, I'll leave now." "Oh, you'll have lunch at home?" "Yes, do you want to come?" "Okay." And he would go.
When he traveled to the States, he left a small sign at the factory. "I'll travel. Tell me what you want." I went with him once, and in general, he was asked to bring medications and things that couldn't be found here. But someone asked him for a cigarette-shaped lighter. When a product is launched in the States, there are millions of it. But when it is sold out, there are none left. I walked and walked and walked, and finally I got fed up. I told him, "Enrique, this is a whim. If they ask you for medications, it's okay. But there's no cigarette-shaped lighters." And he told me, "Don't you realize you travel? You've been to places. Maybe he'll never leave Argentina. Make an effort." I didn't find that lighter, but I found one similar to a pack of cigarettes. I hope he liked it.
Enrique knows the social significance of a businessman. And the words of John Paul II, pronounced before thousands of businessmen on April 11, 1984, in the Luna Park Stadium in a meeting organized by ACDE, seem to be a reflection of his actions.
A company that respects these social purposes clearly demands a deeply human businessman with a profound social interest, which makes him capable of rejecting the inclination towards selfishness and choose the wealth of love over the love for wealth.
He takes care of every detail. He listens and writes down everything he's told and what he thinks of in his famous notebooks. Even the smallest expense is registered, except for some cases, because Enrique remembers very well what he receives, but he loses his memory when it's time to give.
Enrique was already very sick. There was a phone call for him, and I answered. It was a call from what was then the DGI. They wanted him to go there without a haste. Enrique used to give so much that they were surprised and realized the calculations were wrong. So they gave money back to him. I think that was the only time the DGI gave money back to someone.
And if he finds out that an employee is building his own home, he finds the most loving way of helping them without them noticing it.
The end of the year was near, and Rigolo used to give a bonus to the staff, which increased every year. So he increased my bonus, and compared to what I had received the previous year, it was an important sum. And he told me, smiling, to have one more window.
The people who have money have to create workplaces. The ones who are intelligent have to use that intelligence to help others. Enrique leaves to study management at Harvard University. He knows his preaching will be enriched if it is combined with study and a better education. And he was already thinking about taking part in the creation of the future Argentine Catholic University. From there, he writes Cecilia how happy he feels about his life as a student and tells her all the ideas, projects and dreams that crowds into his head. When he returns home, he rushes again into action. He looks like an army working to carry on different ventures.
He had too much work. At first, he only worked in Rigolo, and then he was in Torquins and Torquins Companies. And in the Shaw Bank, that's the way his father bank was called back then.
He even takes part in not-so-profitable companies, which he considers necessary to spread Christian ideas. And he is always in a good mood, showing his permanent smile.
He who knew him as I did, knows Enrique was more prone to smile than to be serious. He had a gentle sense of humor and laughed cheerfully when it was time to laugh. He was very simple, neutral, and very responsible. He was very serious.
And he gets serious, especially when it is about not leaving his people in the streets. So he thinks and thinks. And then, on the 11th of August 1959, when his factory faces a crisis, Enrique sends the staff a circular that summarizes his ideas as a Christian businessman. Employment is, first of all, a moral evil, because it and its sufferings affect human beings, their flesh and hearts. No Christian, no good man, can remain indifferent to the possibility of such a suffering.
He said that there were many sheds in a bad state, which was true, and that they needed painting, remolding, and so he was able to take those people there to work. During 6 months, painting and fixing, everything was left perfect. During those 6 months, there was a recovery, and thank God the people were there. He was then congratulated by the board.
During one of the cyclical crises in which the country was always immersed, I told him there was an idle furnace in Rigolo, that we could turn it on and start manufacturing green glass, which was the most ordinary, most common glass, to punish our competitors. Don't you see? He told me, you think in the business and not in the people, and you make people redundant in another company. Today, that isn't heard. Today it's wild. Today they think how they can destroy you, ruin if possible. That shows exactly how he was and which Enrique's human thoughts were.
There are always many things to do, even if there's little money. Let's try to overcome this poverty of means, but without worrying or giving up when we can't achieve it. Nothing seems to stop him. However, the end of his path is near. Enrique knows he's very sick and accepts it heroically, without complaining. He feels he still has many things to do, and that hurts him more than his illness. He feels he'll abandon his family and he won't be able to protect his workers. But God is calling him, and he is only comforted by his deep faith.
He felt great resignation and acceptance. He had a positive attitude. He wanted to give a religious sense to this. He offered his sacrifice as if completing our Lord's passion. His religious nature was really deep and authentic.
Those who love him wait for a miracle and persuade him to go to Lourdes. He thinks that money can go for those who really need it, but doesn't want to contradict them. So he goes. Enrique's soul knows God's will, knows he's short of time. And this is the moment to give until the end. That's why he doesn't want to be away from his family, even for a moment, because they give him the strength to go on living.
I remember seeing him in this house when he was already sick. He spent more time here. I came once and one of the kids had a problem which wasn't really serious, and they were all in the bedroom playing, throwing pillows. And when I came in, they also threw a pillow at me.
His family and his job make him cling to life. And as a good sailor, he won't abandon ship until the end.
He had the gift of not thinking he was going to die. So he, well, kept on living as if he hadn't that nightmare ahead. He went on planning and thinking and acting.
He gave me an example with his death. A great example. He was so calm that I was afraid. Don't you want to take this? No. I'll do it. Facing death was like facing an exam.
Enrique cannot work anymore. And his workers feel they are the ones who have to give now.
More than 200 people went to donate blood. I don't know, around 250 or 260. And I think most of them came to work. They donated blood and then came to work.
I didn't attend the farewell meeting held in Berazategui, where he told us the illness he suffered. He had that courage, that nobility. I'm sorry.
He gathered the people there to thank them. And he said he was happy because he knew the workers' blood was running through his veins.
And like a gift from God at the end of his life, Enrique makes his dream come true. Now workers' blood runs through his veins. He is now one of them. And the man of the notebook, as some people called him fondly, says goodbye to public life, invoking his celestial partner with words that are part of his legacy, of his spiritual heritage, which still echo today. Let's ask the Virgin Mary to help us understand and to love our mission, and give us light, strength, and joy to improve Argentina. This way, we'll have more to offer God. Before passing away, Enrique makes another dream come true. His father, who had educated him in the Christian faith just to keep a promise, takes communion with him. Sarah, his mother, is also there with him. Enrique dies on August 27, 1962, the day of the 37th anniversary of his mother's death.
The first years, not only did I miss him, but I felt dead. It was terrible.
Well, one misses his presence. He was an Argentinian who devoted himself to his fellow human beings, his fellow countrymen, to businessmen, to church, to his family, to his friends.
He was always an example for me, above all an example in spiritual terms.
He was a model, and I always say this wherever I am, Enrique Shaw was the man. I think he was a model man.
A life centered in Christ, a Christ-centered life. Someone who was intimately and deeply involved with Jesus. And this really allowed him to achieve so many things.
He taught me to be humble, to help people, to understand them.
I think if today 50% of businessmen, or less than 50%, were like Enrique Shaw, none of the things that are going on would happen. Because he said that behind a worker, an employee, there was a mother, a brother, who was waiting for their daily bread.
I think Agde's history is constant as regards the path Enrique Shaw and the group who was with him traced since its foundation.
We learned a lot by looking at the example he gave us with his austerity.
He was in peace. He could really concentrate. And I followed him a lot. So when he said something, I didn't leave. I listened to him and followed him.
We hope Enrique Shaw will someday be proclaimed a saint.
He wasn't afraid. He just moved on. He looked ahead at the cross, at Jesus, at God.
And Enrique Shaw's life, which started in Paris, goes on in the heart of those who knew that mischievous boy, who defied sadness and set sail in pursuit of new experiences. And one day, he found out the secret of real happiness. So he showed it to his mates in the Navy. With love, he told it to his wife. In the factory, his workers were told about it. By playing, his children learned it. He wrote it in 1,000 ways. He repeated it everywhere. And he lived it every second. He obtained what he so much longed for, making others happy. And even today, throughout time, this great man reveals his most valuable secret to us. Enrique smiled and generously gave. Simply because he had found God.